Mage Knight the board game is the newest addition to WizKids' Mage Knight universe from designer Vlad Akhvati.
In Mage Knight, players play powerful warriors that are out to conquer the Atlantean Empire. It has an RPG feel with some deck building and some board game elements. It plays with 1 to 4 players and plays out in 1 to 4 hours.
Mage Knight is a scenario-based game with options for solo, cooperative, and competitive play. Each scenario is going to have the players complete a set objective in a limited number of rounds while trying to gain the most fame. Fame, which also determines your character's level, is tracked on a central board along with reputation, which affects how you interact with the locals.
So players begin by choosing one of the 4 heroes to play, and they take their hero card, their miniature, their deed deck, and their tokens. Now the level tokens are placed in a stack, in an ordered stack, face up on their character card. The top one will show you what your armor is and what your current hand limit is. One of those tokens goes face down in your play area, and that represents your unit command slot. So at the beginning of a turn, player draws cards from their deed deck up to their hand limit.
Now rounds in Mage Knight alternate between day and night, and the round type is going to affect movement costs, how mana is used, and certain combat elements. At the start of each round, the board is flipped to its appropriate side, the mana source is rolled, new units, spells, and advanced actions are put on offer, spent units are refreshed, and each player draws a tactics card. Now this card is going to give you access to one special ability at some point during that round, and it also determines turn order.
So on their turn, a player uses their cards and their skills to move, use special abilities, interact with different areas on the board, or fight. You can play as many cards as you would like from your hand to combine their abilities, or you can play a card sideways to give you +1 to any action. Now every card has a basic effect and a stronger effect. The basic effect is triggered as soon as you play the card. The advanced effect, however, requires you to play a mana token of a particular color.
So mana comes in 4 basic colors that trigger these stronger effects, as well as 2 special round-specific colors, gold and black. Gold tokens are only used during the day and actually represent 1 basic mana token of your choice. Black is only used at night and makes spells more powerful. Once per turn, you can take a die from the source and use it to gain a matching mana token. That die is then re-rolled and put back for other players to use. There's also special actions that can let you generate more mana or turn mana tokens into crystals that you can store for use later on.
Move actions allow you to cross a hex by paying their movement cost, or you can explore by adding a new tile to the map. As soon as a new tile is added, any monsters on there are represented by tokens, and any locations are made available for all players.
So players can enter villages and monasteries freely in order to heal or recruit units. Forts, mage towers, and cities start with a garrison and need to be conquered before you can interact with them. Interaction involves spending influence, and you get a bonus or a penalty depending on your reputation score. Certain locations let you buy advanced action or spell cards, which go in your deed deck. New units go below an available command token and are going to give you an extra action once per round.
Combat in Mage Knight happens when you attack a garrison, provoke rampaging monsters, or enter a special adventuring area like a tomb or a dungeon. Now, if you attack a garrison or burn down a monastery or defeat some rampaging monsters, this is all going to affect your reputation score.
So if the hero makes a ranged or siege attack that equals or exceeds the enemy's armor, then they win combat immediately. Otherwise, they have to block the enemy's attack, or they take damage, which is assigned through wound cards. Each wound added to your hand is going to reduce the total attack value by your hero's armor. Wounds count towards your hand limit, and they can't be removed except by healing. You can also wound a unit instead, and it stays incapacitated until it's been healed. On top of that, a lot of enemies have special characteristics that are going to affect how they take and deal damage.
So after surviving that enemy attack, players have one more chance to defeat the enemy and get the fame and the treasure that they're going to get. However, if they're defeated, they're going to have to retreat to safer ground.
So when a player earns enough fame to go up a row on the track, then their hero levels up. At even numbered levels, they get a skill tile and an advanced action card. And the skills available to each hero are very different, so one of the keys to Mage Knight is learning how to build your character to play to their strengths. If it's an odd-numbered level, then a new command token is turned over, which creates a new unit command slot, as well as revealing better hero stats.
At the end of their turn, a player discards any unused mana tokens that they have, as well as placing any cards that they've played in their discard pile. They also have the choice to discard any non-wound cards that they have in their hand. They then draw back up to their hand limit, and if this exhausts their deed deck, then they have the choice to declare the end of the round or to continue with their actions. The game ends after a certain number of rounds, or if the scenario objective has been attained.
So I really, really like Mage Knight, and one of the reasons for this is it's a great game to play solo. I don't know of many other games that are this engaging when it's just you and the board. The other thing about this game that's great is that the interaction between all of the bits and pieces, the skills that you have available, the monsters that come up, the things that you can interact with, is really what builds the game, so there's a huge amount of replay value and a real sense of immersion. Unfortunately, all of that interaction means that the decision-making involved can be really complex. You don't have that many elements available in your hand, and there's a lot that you may want to do. And that means that there can be a lot of downtime for other players while you're trying to figure out what you're doing. So this game tends to work best for me with a very low number of players, like one or two.
So another con for this game is it is very, very complex. So the first time that you play the game might be a bit of a write-off, especially if you've got a lot of players playing. There's a lot of little bits to learn. There's a lot of cards and a lot of game elements. And it's that beginning learning process is going to be frustrating for some people. However, a positive side is the theme for this game is really fantastic. The uniqueness of the characters is really interesting. The way you level up is really different. It's really engaging in that way. Another great thing is the components. The art is beautiful. The little mana pieces are gorgeous. It's fun to play with this game because all the pieces feel like they're really high quality. So I think one of the ways that this game could be improved is if we add an elf barbarian to the mix. I think that would be a perfect addition to this game, especially a really inept, really bad at being a barbarian elf barbarian. I think that would really, you know, add a lot of flavor to this game. I suggest that we draw on Standard Actions Edda as a new hero character